everyone to the second journal club together with ACE, ISAR and IFS. This journal club will be led by Dr. Rajvi Mehta, who will be talking about striking a balance between innovation and safety concerns in ART. The journal club will be moderated by Dr. Kuldeep Jain. So the flow would be that Dr. Rajvi Mehta would be taking us through the journal club, and post that whatever questions you have, you can post in the chat window, and Dr. Kuldeep Jain would be sharing those questions with Dr. Rajvi by the end of the journal club. So to start with, let me introduce Dr. Kuldeep Jain. He's a senior person known to all of us. He doesn't really need an introduction. He has more than 30 years of experience in ART. He is a senior IVF consultant and a laparoscopic surgeon. Currently the director of KJIVF. He has more than 35 publications and more than 200 lectures to his credit. He is also responsible and has been instrumental in launching and establishing the pre-ISHWE course and the IFS certification in India. He's also been the part of various committees in FOCSI, example, the chairperson for endometriosis from 2017 to 19. Also other committees like TOG, PCOS, ovulatory disorders, etc. So Dr. Kuldeep, I'll hand it over to you now to take forward the journal club.
Thank you, Shipra, and welcome to this combined activity of IFS, ISAR and ACE. And let me congratulate Cooper Surgical for bringing this concept in the period of lockdown to bring the people together and make them aware in this difficult period. Today we are going to discuss a subject which is actually not very commonly discussed in many of the platforms. So I think this is a very good opportunity for all of us to go through whatever is available in our ART field. As we are all aware that ART is a very fast growing branch, and it is having lot of gray areas, lot of limitations. And because of these limitations, the newer methodologies and newer concepts and newer procedures, they keep on getting researched and getting introduced into our clinical practice. Whenever some new advance comes, it is easily introduced into the system. Whether it is useful or not, whether what are the safety of that procedure or that concept, usually that goes behind. Ideally, what should be the case? It should be any new procedure, it should be effective, it should be safe, and it should be usable. It should be applicable to maximum number of the patients. So these are few things which needs to be looked into, all newer concepts or newer procedures. But whether it is happening or not, I think we are going to have a very good discussion today on this subject. The topic is striking a balance between innovation and safety concerns in ART. And we are having the very efficient person, Rajvi Mehta, who is actually a very good orator and very good teacher. I think most of you must have heard somewhere. Let me introduce her. She is currently working as academic consultant at Cooper Surgical India. She has done her doctoral studies at ICMR Institute with the team which was basically responsible for first IVF baby in India. And she worked as clinical embryologist and now involved in teaching and training in ART. She has received the Indian Society of Assisted Reproduction Young Scientist Award in the year of inception, and recently received Champion of ISAR Award. She is a very thorough worker, and she is a member of the Executive Committee of Academy of Clinical Embryologists India. She is also leading a special interest group on holistic medicine for Indian Fertility Society. She is one of the faculty of our SRE embryology course, preparatory course, which we are running for last 7 years. And I have heard her many times. She is really a wonderful teacher. So let us invite Dr. Rajvi for today's journal club. At the end of it, we will be taking the questions. So please send your questions on the chat board, so we can discuss, we can make it an interactive discussion. Dr. Rajvi, please.
Thank you, Dr. Kuldeep, for the very elaborate introduction, and I also thank Cooper Surgical for starting this initiative of the Journal Club. Last week, we had a very fine presentation from Dr. Krishna Chaitanya about KPIs and how we should start raising our bars to reach the optimal level of success in whatever practices that we do. And today I'll be primarily be talking about the striking a balance between innovation and safety concerns in ART. Because today, I'm sure, what is the situation today in our country, I would say all over the world, in the current situation of lockdown because of the COVID virus. What would happen is that a large number of us would be sitting in front of the computer monitors, listening to webinars. We just discussed there are possibly more than 4 to 5 webinars happening a day in each topic, or possibly presenting. There would be another group which is totally stressed out about what the future is going to be. And on the other hand, there'll be a lot of us, many who have just started their clinics would also be under a lot of stress because cases need to start. I mean, how long can one be sitting because of all the investment going and the patients waiting? There is a third group, which would be the innovators, who are possibly using this time to think of any new ideas by which we can improve our results, by which we could get, you know, better embryos, better blastocysts, and finally better pregnancy rates and healthy babies. While there would also be many of us, and I think the seniors in the field, who would be taking this time to contemplate and reflect on what we have done so far and what the future can be. And I'm talking more on the capacity of the last category, where one is contemplating and reflecting on how the field of ART has grown and where it can go from now. What are the things we need to consider? And it's in this midst that this paper, which is just published last month, it has not yet in the Human Reproduction Open Journal. It's a new journal which was just started earlier this year. And this paper primarily talks about the striking a balance. So what between innovation and precaution, how did offspring safety considerations play a role in strategies of introducing newer reproductive techniques? So basically, we are trying to understand that how do we introduce new technologies? I mean, it is whenever we hear somebody saying they've used a new technology and that it's going to give us good results, we want to jump onto it. We want to get it into our clinics. And, you know, if we go back in time and most of the clinicians, all the clinicians, the embryologists haven't done it, you talk about do no harm. And how much of this is really followed in the field of ART? Is it practically possible to follow this in the field of ART? Because to some extent, we cannot have 100% success and we are not sure of the outcomes of the babies are born through these ARTs. So having said that, we go that what are the safety concerns assisted reproductive technology per se. It's been nearly 40 years, 42 years to be precise, since the first IVF baby was born. And the fact that this technology has invaded the world, are we really having some safety concerns? And this review primarily starts on the premise that a lot of these technologies have been introduced without systematic preclinical safety and effectiveness studies. We haven't undergone the drastic, stringent trials before introducing many add-ons to the ART technologies. And the ultimate success of an ART technology would be the birth of a healthy child. And there hasn't been much of a follow-up of children conceived with ART, especially the newer variants of the procedures or the add-ons, as we often call it in this procedures. And it's not me saying that, it's not us saying that. There are a series of papers written in the last 3 to 4 years, which are now addressing the safety concerns with ART. Now, when we talk of safety, we are talking of two issues, safety and effectiveness. Now, when I say effectiveness, it is ability of the ART service or the add-ons that we give to give a desired result. So any introduction of a new technology is effective. It gives us the desired result. On the other hand, safety is whether it is having any kind of adverse effects. So in a way, both are talking the same things, but one is balancing the other. Now, having said that, if we want any technology to be effective or any addition to that we do to this field of ART to give the desired result, then what is the desired result? As an embryologist, I would be happy if I have more number of embryos and blastocysts developing from the technology, modifications of the technology I used. I would be happier if we get more good quality embryos and blastocysts. Yes, better pregnancy and implantation rates. The desired result would be a high take-home baby rate. The desired result could be healthy babies born following this technology, and not just healthy babies. How far are we going to say the technology is giving a successful, effective result would be the baby being healthy at the time of birth, or the baby able to succeed in crossing all the different milestones, or do we measure the baby till adulthood and the subsequent reproductive consequences? So it depends on what we see as a desired result, and which would vary from an embryologist to a clinician to the parent or to the couple. Now, when we talk of the what are the potential adverse effects? I mean, are there really any adverse effects of ART? Let's face it, millions of babies have been born. There are thousands of clinics across the world. The number is rising exponentially. Then are there any adverse effects? Because if any technology has adverse effects, it won't survive for 40 years. Well, some of the adverse effects of parts of the technology has been our initial obsession of quantity at the cost of quality. So we went in for higher number of follicles, and we had the risks of OHSS, which now has come down with newer protocols. We had the risk of multiple pregnancies with multiple oocytes and embryos recovered and transferred. There are also a lot of theoretical risks, and theoretical risks are based on some physiological understanding as well as based on the invasiveness of the technologies, certain technologies that we use. So there are the actual risks, which are determined from the basis of some evidence that we get from preclinical studies. So animal studies, preclinical studies have indicated there are certain risks with the technology. A technology is not black and white. If it has zero risk or 100% risk, if it has 100% risk, we are going to discard it right at the start. And there is no technology which would say there is zero risk. So we are somewhere in the gray zone. And based on the animal studies and preclinical studies, if we know it has a risk, we will need to find out the population which would be affected by the risk. And then we would also have a follow-up of the offsprings. And as I just said, how long are you going to follow up these offsprings? Is it practically possible? So when can we say that this technology is absolutely safe? So the reason that this idea about safety has come up with the whole knowledge of the developmental origin of health and disease. And this developmental origin of health and disease is primarily stimulated from Barker's hypothesis. And Barker actually did studies many years ago looking at women who were pregnant during World War II under extremely difficult conditions. And they found that the children born during that time from parents who were pregnant during these extremely stressful times, actually they did not grow up into healthy adults. And the variation in nutrition in early life influenced the disease in adult life. And therefore, an environment in which the fetus and the infant grew in a compromised environment. And these children who later became adults had a higher risk for ischemic heart disease. And undernutrition during gestation was a very important early origin of adult cardiac disease and metabolic disorders. So having said that, and if somebody were to extend it still further in the still below in the timeline, then one would question that would the environment in which the embryos grow affect the fetus and thereby the adult in future? Now, that is the primary concern about ART. And actually speaking, with millions of babies born, there is nothing drastic that we have seen so far that can indicate that Barker's hypothesis can be extended for the development origin of health and disease. But does that mean that because there is nothing as drastic like the thalidomide disaster that had come up, can we be complacent and think that all our technologies are absolutely safe and there's nothing to be worried about? The fact is, we may not have followed them up enough. We may follow up our babies till the pregnancy, and in some cases a little more. But how practical it is, or how, because in very often we have ART clinics which may not even be doing delivery. So once the pregnancy is confirmed, that woman is a couple is taken care of by a totally another obstetrician, and so we may have no idea about the health or the outcome of the pregnancy also. So for any ideal situation for any new technology that we wish to introduce would be following up the offscreens. And I said it's absolutely very, very difficult to monitor this. And how long do we wait? Suppose we want to say, yes, this technology is 100% successful or safe, then what we need to do is monitor that technology till live birth, till beyond. And then practically, imagine if somebody would have done that for ART or for ICSI, then today we would have no pregnancies yet with ICSI because we would be waiting for the outcome, reproductive outcome of the first baby born through ICSI. And therefore, we would be denying millions of couples of this technology. So in real life, there is nothing ideal when we always have to strike a balance between what could be ideal and what we can really do. So therefore, in this paper, they are primarily talking of two extreme principles which are to be implemented in the field of ART. What they talk about is a precautionary principle, which is put up by Persadin in 1999, talking of uncertain risk. And as I said, in our technology, there are a lot of uncertain risks. So what this principle says is, if there is a threat which is uncertain, then some kind of action is mandatory. But what kind of action? Secondly, on the other hand, a person, so maybe I would call the precautionary principle a mindset of a pessimist, that we have to be very careful of what we do. And the innovation principle, which could be a mindset of an optimist, would say that if the call is for the benefits of innovation to be weighed against known harm. So if my technology does not show any harm, then I need not be too obvious harm, or I have no evidence for it, then I need not be weighed down by that technology and I should utilize it. Well, in reality, what we function is a balance between these two. And what do? We do a balance between these two. Now, this particular paper has taken three specific technologies for discussion regarding safety versus effectiveness and how we introduce this technology or use this technology, because ICSI and PGTA do not need introduction. They are in use already. And mitochondrial replacement therapy. So talking of ICSI, we all know that ICSI was not intended as a control study. It was a serendipitous discovery. When in cases of male factor infertility, when there were very few sperms, people were trying to inject the sperm into the perivitelline space, into the zonas. So we had subzonal insemination. And one day by mistake, the needle went deeper into the oocyte and one landed up with intracytoplasmic sperm injection. Now the point is, why did they not do it earlier? Were they not aware of it? Of course, they would have thought of it. But the reason was they were very concerned about the oocyte, which have been in a very active state of activity, having being a mature oocyte. They were possibly very concerned about the outcomes of directly injecting the sperm into the oocyte. But it happened. The experiment discovery, the serendipitous discovery was repeated, and then the technology came into use. And there were a lot of criticisms then that ICSI is being used without any animal testing. In fact, studies in animals came in much later. Then there were no clinical trials done at all. The question remained, how do we select the sperm for ICSI? And this question still is valid today. I mean, can the human eye and hand mimic the role of the zona? We don't think so. And therefore, a lot of selection is still based on personal judgment, although there are many new technologies that have come in to help us select a better sperm. But it is better within what was available. And then there has also been concern on the use of testicular and epididymal sperm. Now, having said that, with ICSI, we do know that ICSI does not lead to any major abnormalities in offscreens, and I'm sure all the audience here would agree to it, because ICSI is being done left, right, center, and we have not really seen anything that should get us to get worried. And there is also a report which says that boys conceived after ICSI have lower sperm quality. But then that would not be a major cause of concern, because ICSI any case is being done for male infertility. And when these boys grow up, there would be other technologies, and if not, ICSI is always there for them to lead to a pregnancy. On the other hand, there are certain concerns that have come up with ICSI. ICSI is associated with a significantly increased risk of very preterm delivery. And a very preterm delivery would mean a lower mean birth weight, even in those who have had a full-term delivery. And there is also an increased risk of rare imprinting disorders in comparison to spontaneously conceived or non-ICSI, pardon the error, in the conventional IVF pregnancies. So this clearly indicates that there is something happening in case of ICSI, which is affecting the outcome, at least in, there is a significant effect on the outcome. Now, so what are the issues? Where could these problems be coming in? Is it because of the technique itself? After all, we are injecting the oocyte, we are putting in PVP and all into the oocyte. Would that be the cause for this kind of a report? Or is it just that there are underlying paternal conditions? After all, we are doing ICSI in cases of maybe certain kind of disorders or in cases of infertility. And that itself could be the cause of these significant abnormalities that were found. So it could be either of the two. Now, so knowing this kind of information, especially on the low preterm births as well as low birth weight reported, should we be doing ICSI for all ART cases? As of now, there is no data which shows it to be more effective than conventional IVF for conditions other than male infertility problems. Especially if we have a young woman with tubal factor, with mild endometriosis, where the male factor is normal, there is no data showing that ICSI is better than conventional IVF at all. So the current situation does not warrant ICSI for all, because the advantage that we get by doing ICSI for all, the only discussion we always keep having for ICSI for all is, we say that total failed fertilization. How often does that occur? So having said that, but the potential risk is definitely higher than the potential advantage. So it clearly shows that in cases which do not merit ICSI, we should not be going for ICSI for all. So if you have a young woman, tubal factor, mild endometriosis, as I just said earlier, you can still safely go in with conventional IVF, is that is what the data suggests. Now then comes in epididymal sperm and testicular sperm. Obviously they were used in cases of very, very severe male infertility, severe oligospermia or azoospermia. Now the concerns that were raised, and these were, I would say, more theoretical concerns, is that we were using sperms that were old or not fully mature. So if we are taking an epididymal sperm aspiration, the sperms have been there for a period of time, and there was this concern that these sperms have been there, maybe they have been exposed to a lot of oxidative stress and therefore they would have higher DNA damage. Or if you're taking testicular sperms, maybe they are not fully mature sperms and would have genetic imprinting disorders. So should we be going for MESA, TESA, TESI all the time? And whilst there is this concern of safety, one would definitely, like, would, if one says no ICSI for all, definitely it's not going to be MESA, TESA at all, for all. Netherlands, on the other hand, went to a state of extreme caution. What they decided was that they would not go for MESA and all the testicular or epididymal sperms. And in fact, a national moratorium was given against epididymal and testicular sperms. And then they got data from animal studies and data from other countries where these technologies were being used. And finally, they allowed these technologies to be done in a clinical research setting only in 2000, and for testicular sperm only in 2007. And then finally in 2012 and 2014, they lifted this moratorium, and then it was possible for male infertility patients to undergo this technology. So when they were so cautious about the potential damage that testicular use of testicular sperm could lead to, they delayed the implementation of this technology for more than 10 to 14 years. And in this process, what happened is, the how many number of patients who lost out on treatment, the severe male infertility patients who could possibly have conceived using testicular and epididymal sperm, but lost out because the country's policies were on the realm of extreme caution on the use of this technology. So about ICSI, I repeat, ICSI is not meant for all, but in cases where indicated. And testicular sperm, of course, indicated, but we need not go into the extreme realm of super caution. Coming to pre-implantation genetics, let me get the technology or the terminology clear. We have PGD, which was used for genetic diagnosis in cases of known genetic disorders in the couple. Pre-implantation genetic screening was the old term used, primarily to detect aneuploidy. These terminologies have been redefined, and we have PGTA, is pre-implantation genetic testing for aneuploidy, M for monogenic disorders, and SR for structural rearrangements. Now, when PGT came in, the concerns and the possible risks that went with the PGT. One is the risk with the procedure itself. Finally, we are biopsying the embryo, cleavage stage or blastocyst. We are going to use specific embryo culture media. Then there was this concern that you're removing cells. Would they have any effect on the future development of the embryo blastocyst? Although we very well know that the embryo is a totipotent cell, the blastocyst is a pluripotent cell, so there is a potential for each of these cells to develop further. And then, of course, when we did trophectoderm biopsy, there was this initial concern about extended culture and cryopreservation, which today may not be true because extended culture is quite common and cryopreservation is now is an absolutely essential technology. So what was the concern with the procedure? Well, there is this fear of damage to the embryo or blastocyst, which is a real concern. I mean, whenever we are using a mechanical procedure, the risks will always remain. It is highly skill dependent, and therefore the risk of damage to the embryo will always remain. There's also the concern that because we are doing this procedure, the embryos are lying outside in suboptimal culture conditions. They're not in the incubator, and with so many studies showing that even a few minutes of the embryo outside the optimal CO2 environment can create problems. And then the use of specific embryo culture media could affect certain offspring parameters going back to the developmental origin of health and disease. So if we talk about the removal of cells, well, the early studies in mice and humans have shown an association of blastomere biopsy with impaired implantation potential. Now the question is this impaired implantation potential because of the removal of cells or because of the technique itself? And they've also shown reduced and delayed fetal development in these cases where biopsies of the embryos has been done. And that's the reason that one went from cleavage stage embryos to trophectoderm. One is in trophectoderm, you have many more cells, so the error of judgment is much lessened. And then we felt that the loss of a few trophectoderm cells should not matter, because after all, the trophectoderm is going to become the placenta, so there should be no problem to the fetus, because you're not removing any of the fetal cells. But recent studies in the last 2-3 years have shown that even removing trophectoderm cells results in a smaller placenta, which in turn could lead to incorrect embryo development and abnormalities in the offspring. So how safe are we with trophectoderm biopsy? Again, these are certain reports of a delayed development. So having said that, then the concern with extended culture, because we culture longer and there are studies which clearly show that using different kind of media have a different effect on the birth weight. And this extended culture is, as of now, a perennial debate on day 3 versus day 5. And it will go on and on. I really don't want to comment on it. But then blastocyst culture has its advantages and disadvantages, which is a topic for another debate. How, and even talking of the impact of cryopreservation, that concern came in when there was a report that singleton pregnancies following frozen embryo transfer are associated with higher risk of higher birth weight babies compared with those from fresh embryo transfer. Well, this paper has been highly debated. And secondly, we always talk of babies following IVF or conventional IVF or ICSI being low birth weight. Maybe we are not too very concerned about the relatively higher birth weight babies following cryopreservation because it possibly neutralizes the situation. However, if we combine all the different technologies that are being used for PGTA, there is very little data available on PGTA and cryopreservation and whether it really makes a difference. What are the safety measures that have been taken? In the early days, possibly when people were not very confident with PGT, all PGT cases were asked to confirm their results with prenatal diagnostic techniques, which is more of caution on the PGT technique done. It was more to make sure that the efficacy of the technique, because an error in PGT, if there was an abnormal baby born after PGT, would be quite a disaster. And UK HFEA did not allow PGT for a long period of time because they thought that the risks arising from embryo biopsy, and it was felt by their ethic, and they felt that all the studies that were done so far, the ethics committee had not taken proper account of the absence of evidence of no risk. They felt that the risks from biopsy were very high and all these ethical committees of all the studies done so far were not enough. And therefore, it became very restrictive on the use of PGT. Well, in reality, how safe is PGT? We do know that PGTA, there is a global proliferation, PGTA is being done. And especially when we moved from fish to the second generation, where we are doing trophectoderm biopsy, so the chances of error occurring of cleavage stage embryos are lesser. And then we are screening all the chromosomes. So it has become more efficient, the technology of PGTA, and therefore it is being done. And all the follow-up studies research does not show any higher degree of major abnormalities in the children born after PGTA in comparison with IVF ICSI only. So a couple of studies show, so like ICSI, the study showing with PGTA show that there is not a higher degree of abnormalities and these technologies are fairly safe. However, children born following PGTM or PGTSR have an increased risk of adverse obstetric and neonatal outcomes. And that may not be very, very surprising. It may have nothing to do with the pre-implantation genetic technology. It is utilizing because these technologies have been used for underlying parental conditions. And so the concern is that, you know, we may have prevented the genetic disorder, but there are certain obstetric outcomes which seem to be compromised with the use of PGTM. Having said that, what is the effectiveness? So PGTA, we can say, is fairly safe to use. What is the effectiveness of PGTA? Well, there is not much evidence to show that the effectiveness of this procedure is very, very effective, and the treatment's rationale is under discussion. In the sense, why we talk about the treatment's rationale being under discussion, because if there is aneuploidy, we also talk about the ability of embryo to correct. We also talk about the discarding of the embryos or early miscarriages that can happen. We can also say that, you know, there is a auto-correction. We talk about mosaicism a lot in PGT, but in reality, we know that mosaicism is not that much of a problem. But having said that, is it really, we do not have a lot of evidence to show that it is a very effective technology in an entire or a PGTA for all. It's not, I mean to say, it's an effective technology for specific groups, but not that each and every case should undergo PGTA. And there are no very limited follow-up studies on the health of children born after PGTA in combination with trophectoderm biopsy. So whatever the earlier studies were primarily with cleavage stage embryos. So with that, what should be the use of PGTA? Well, originally PGTA was recommended and carried out as an add-on for women with advanced maternal age, repeated IVF failure, repeated pregnancy rot, miscarriage. However, today it is being offered to younger women with good pregnancy prognosis. And just before this lockdown came in, there was the report that in future we need to be doing pre-implantation genetic diagnosis for all embryos. Highly debated at that point of time, but we felt there was a misunderstanding in the act that came in, and of course it would be discussed once things normalize here. But we still maybe today we need to recommend PGTA only in such cases, and it cannot be PGTA for all. I would be happy to mention here that last year there was a ISAR, ACE, IFS consensus meeting held thanks to Cooper Surgical, and all the people who came from all these three major societies came to the same conclusion that PGTA should be used only in cases with advanced maternal age, repeated IVF failure and repeated miscarriage. There was a unison in all the three societies and all the members of this facial add-on group that it should not be for all. Then comes mitochondrial replacement therapy. It initially started like ICSI started for male infertility, PGTA started for the specific groups and then was extended. Mitochondrial replacement therapy was primarily being used to prevent transmission of mitochondrial diseases through the oocyte to the offspring. And there are many techniques that are being used. The two most common one is the maternal spindle transfer, where the spindle chromosome complex from the oocyte is transferred from the recipient oocyte or the commissioning couple into a donor oocyte. And in another, you let the zygote develop and then the pronuclei are removed from the recipient zygote and transferred to a donor oocyte whose pronuclei have been, which has been enucleated. So the ooplasm in which the new pronuclei grow would be that from a healthy donor oocyte. What are the theoretical risks of mitochondrial replacement therapy? Would be that maybe we may not be able to totally prevent the transfer of mitochondrial diseases. We are extensively reducing the number of mitochondria or abnormal disease mitochondria by removing the pronuclei from the infected mitochondria, if I may say so. Then, of course, there is always a concern when we do any kind of manipulation, whether that could have adverse effects. So any technique which involves an invasive technique, there is a concern. And there is also a thing that the oocytes that have received their nucleus from a donor, in a report they found, were less likely to develop into a blastocyst than oocytes who had their own nucleus injected back into them. So what they really did is they removed, just to see whether the technique had a problem. What they did is they took oocytes, let them develop to zygotes, removed the pronuclei, cryopreserve, put them back again, and in another, it was a donor pronuclei. Now, it is not very clear that the problems that occur were because of suboptimal interaction between the nucleus of the recipient and the mitochondria of the donor, or just from the oocyte cryopreservation after enucleating. So these are theoretical risks. There have been no studies which clearly indicate that, yes, there is a practical risk evidenced by some kind of a concern. You know, ICSI just jumped in for PGTA. There has been caution. And I think for mitochondrial replacement therapy, there has been extreme caution before introducing it. So there has been a lot of preclinical research before the introduction of the technology. There were studies performed in animals, including non-human primates, which was not done in case of ICSI. And the human embryos also, so human embryos donated for research, were tested for safety of this technique. And UK especially has been on the forefront for this. And they had all these studies in place before they removed all the legal restrictions and permitted MRT, mitochondrial replacement therapy, for use in specific clinical settings. In fact, this was great news, not only for the reproductive biologist and the ART clinics, but this became news worldwide for the general public too. And there are studies also, they went further to look at the consequences of MRT on epigenetic modifications and gene expression in embryos from PNTs and mitochondrial spindle transfer. So basically, these technologies have undergone much more safety considerations than the previous technology. And then they permitted the use of MRT under strict regulation. So it was offered to women who had a high risk of transmitting a serious mitochondrial disease, where even PGT was not an alternative. And HFEA actually permitted the Newcastle group for the first clinical license to start MRT, which resulted in the first patient in 2018. And after that, this group has accepted various women for different indications for mitochondrial replacement therapy. But according to this paper, there have been no pregnancies still reported from this group. And they have insisted that there should be a long-term follow-up, but considering the practical limitations, they say at least for 18 months, these babies born from mitochondrial replacement therapy should be monitored. And they further add on that any female child born following MRT should use PGT for her own children in future. So they're being extremely cautious and safe while using this technology. This is in the UK. What about the rest of the world? What are the reports and policies that are being used for mitochondrial replacement therapy? Way back in 2003, there was a collaboration between US and China, which possibly is unthinkable now. But in those situations, this collaboration actually reported the first baby following transfer of pronuclear transfer. And it resulted in the death of two fetuses. So pregnancy did occur, but after selective fetal reduction, there was death. This led to US and China imposing prohibitive policies, which even till today, they do not permit mitochondrial replacement therapy. But does that mean that this technology is not being new? No. There was the first baby which was born with mitochondrial spindle transfer, but this procedure was done in Mexico. Possibly the team involved was a US-China collaboration, but it was not done in their own countries. It was done in a country which did not have any policies or regulations. And the first birth following pronuclear transfer was reported not for mitochondrial diseases, but in the case of embryo arrest, and these reports came from Ukraine. Furthermore, mitochondrial spindle transfer, the mitochondrial replacement therapies have been reported in Spain and Greece, and that too for female infertility. So what it says is that this treatment modality came in for a specific situation of mitochondrial disorders, and like any technology, it has been extended for various other indications. Now, the fact is, how safe are these in consideration of the other indications? Now, what is the current scenario with reference to mitochondrial replacement therapy? There are many centers across the world who have started offering mitochondrial replacement therapy, not just for mitochondrial diseases, which could be transmitted from the mother to the offspring, but also as a means of rejuvenating the eggs of older women. It is something what was being used as ooplasm transfer way back in the late 90s. So there is a premature widening of the indications for the use of mitochondrial replacement therapy. And although it is being used, ASHRAE has strongly condemned it, and they have actually gone ahead to discourage the use of mitochondrial replacement therapy for fertility problems until this technique has been proven to be effective and safe. So although it is talked about a lot, although it is being tried in many, many places, there is still a concern on it, on its effectivity and its safety. So the mitochondrial replacement therapy for fertility problems may actually be less risky, but there is lack of evidence on its effectiveness. I mean, what risk does one expect in terms of mitochondrial replacement? We are using invasive technologies for a while, and we have not seen anything which would make us very worried about, say, ICSI or PGT, but there is no evidence of effectiveness. Is it really going to help women who have older oocytes? So there are no proven benefits to outbalance the potential risk. So if we want to introduce something, we should show that it is beneficial by just, instead of just adding it. So what is the balance? I mean, these were three case scenarios of ICSI way back in time. We have PGT, which started also way back in time, but is now with the newer generation of genetic analysis technologies available, they are very much in with us now. And the relatively very new, well-tested for safety, we have the mitochondrial replacement therapy. Now, when should we go rushing in for innovation? It could be this or it could be anything else. Many small minor changes have to be put into ART. Now, one is that we would like to, all of us want to improve our results. So whenever we hear of a new technology, we want to add it to our repertoire if it's going to help us get our patients pregnant. Very often, some of us are very cautious and we want to see how this technology fares before jumping into it or adding it to our clinical practice. But on the other hand, there may be some of us would like to be the first. There's a new technology, why not I give it to my patients? There are also certain commercial gains of having a new technology, and we may want to jump onto it. Some of us have the guts to take the risk. Some would be very cautious. For example, if you are in a very small community and you know all the patients, you may be very, very cautious of taking risks, because the patients may be known to you. So if you are in a very small town and all the patients' families sort of well known, you would be on the verge of more of a caution than taking the risk. And secondly, you know, whether we should go for long preclinical trials, which will delay the availability of technology to your patients and also the costs that go with it. So, you know, when should one rush for innovation? The reasons why one rushes are variable, but at some point we need to go in for innovation. We can't be saying that I did this years, then you would be sitting with similar pregnancy rates and reports. On the other hand, there may be a group who would be very, very cautious, who just wouldn't move. They're stuck like a red light. And that group would be, you know, they would say that anything is a potential risk to a child. We have to be very careful before implementing it. And the purpose of any technology is not to give better blastocysts or implantation rates or pregnancy rates. The purpose of a technology is to give a healthy child. And one can even say, what is the plight of infertility worse than that plight of a parent who has an abnormal child, which could be attributed to the innovation that we have had in. And then there's a balance between a theoretical risk versus a real risk. And these are the people who would be extremely cautious. And I'm sure people who belong to this would not actually get into ART. So basically, it's all about moderation. It's striking the right balance. It is going between the innovative principle and the precautionary principle, or one can say, like, you have all the options, or like the Gita says, it's all about moderation. It's getting the right balance. And what is the right balance? Well, we definitely need more and more research to reduce the uncertainty. When we start anything, there is uncertainty. But as research progresses, many of our doubts, which are theoretical, can get clarified either way of them being safe or unsafe. Animal studies, wherever possible, need to be done. However, we need to realize that animal studies are often not totally extendable to humans. So all animal studies cannot be extrapolated to humans. So they have their limitations, but at the same time, they give us some more clarity. Studies need to be performed on human gametes and embryos donated for research. A long-term follow-up of children born from these technologies is absolutely a must. And it would be, I think, more prudent for us to use these newer innovations and technology only where indicated. There's no point in jumping to a technology because it's available, but you should use it initially only for the indications why it is. So, and then avoid over-treatment. Because what you mean by over-treatment is like saying an infertile couple comes in and put them through ICSI, PGTA, PGTA. Or the woman is in the slighter, older age group, also add on mitochondrial replacement therapy. So we need to be very cautious in how we offer the different technologies to these individuals. Now what are the risk versus benefits? Well, if we say that we are going to set the bar at that only healthy babies born would be a technology which is risk-free, then that is setting the bar too high, because practically it's not going to be possible to have healthy babies born after each and every embryo transfer that has been done. So we will need to take risk. We cannot be free from risk when we are doing an ART, and especially when we introduce new technology. But there has to be some evidence of these technologies being effective. The evidence can come slowly. Evidence could be there from smaller trials that have been done. Then one need to really identify the potential benefits should outweigh the risks that are going to happen. So if I'm going to do, like I give this very simple example for all those who talk about ICSI for all, is that if as an individual you have an option of medical therapy versus surgical therapy, which would you go for? And I'm sure if there is an option, even the surgeons may opt for a medical therapy instead of a surgical therapy if there is an option favoring that. So same way, what is the potential benefit and what is the potential risk? And if the benefit outweighs the risk, we need to take a jump into this newer technology, and we should not leave the choices totally to the patient and be safe under an informed consent. The patients we ourselves find it so difficult after being in the field also for so many decades to be in clear judgment on the safety and effectiveness of any technology. We look for data, we look for our own experience, we look for meta-analysis, we look for Cochrane reviews to come to a very clear decision on newer add-on technologies. And so we cannot just leave it to the patients. It would be just trying to be legally safe. I think it becomes our responsibilities also are much higher when we are using newer technologies. So having said that, I think the only way we can be sure that our technologies are safe would be to have a good record on follow-up on the babies born. I mean, any kind of studies will not, any kind of trials will not stand for the actual follow-up of the babies born. And for that, maybe it's a time to start innovating to how do we track these babies. It's nearly impossible to believe that if we are able to track, every clinic is able to track their babies. But maybe there could be some innovative thoughts on how it could be done. And if we were to follow up on these babies, we'll have very clear guidelines and indications on how safe the newer technologies are. So with this, if there are any questions, it was, I would say, a little challenging a topic because but one thing I would like to say is that in the last ISAR consensus, where we had people from clinicians to embryologists and discussing these topics of add-ons, nobody took personal motivations, whether they had the technology themselves or whether they had the skills themselves. All thought about the patient and then came to a consensus on what is best for the patient. And the general consensus on add-ons was we should use them where indicated and not be using them loosely just because we have the technologies. So while this paper came in now, I must admit that we were fairly far ahead when last year we came to a similar consensus of being moderate in our utilization of add-on or newer technologies. So thank you very much for your patient hearing, and maybe if there are any questions, Dr. Kuldeep.
Thank you, Rajiv. It was an excellent review of these three technologies. I know it was a very difficult talk, but you made it so simple, and you have given, I think, a lot of hints how we should take these innovation in our practice. I will like to say when innovations, they will keep on coming, and they should come. Because nothing is perfect at present in ART, and there are more failure than the success. So innovations are going to come. The problem arises when the innovations are used for wrong indications. Like most of the time, the innovations are coming for one particular indication. And what happens? Another indication is added to that innovation that can be used for say PGD. When the PGD came or PGT came, it was actually for the to find out the whether it is aneuploidy or euploidy, okay, or some defect, chromosomal defect. But then suggestion came that it can be used to increase the chances of success in IVF program. And there was the problem which was introduced at that point of time, because there was no study whether it can be used for all patients to improve the chances of success. So I think before adding an extra indication, there should be more and more studies for that particular indication, and then only it should come into practice. Actually, what happens, it doesn't go like that. There are no long-term follow-ups, and another indication is added. So I think we need to balance the thing. Any innovation should have four components. Like, it has to be effective. That is first very important, which you highlighted. It has to be effective. Safe, it has to be safe. Most of the time, when the innovation comes into the clinic, it is effective procedure, but safety aspect is not studied. Maybe there are not many preclinical trials, and it is introduced into the clinics. So preclinical trials are must for any innovation to reduce the chances of risk. Risk are going to be there, and there are many theoretical risk, and there are many practical risk or real risk. Now, real risk will come only when you use the technology.
Right.
Theoretical risk, we know that this is the theoretical risk. When we are taking a biopsy, there are chances of damaging the embryo. That is that we know.
Yes.
But what will be the outcome of that until unless we do that? So we have to make a balance. Theoretical risk can be seen before we can try to improve the innovation, but real risk, until unless we do the procedure, we will not know. So that is the limitation of the procedure. So we have to keep the limitation also in mind before deciding whether we have to use the procedure or not. Another thing which I will like to highlight is how do you select whether this concept or procedure needs to be used or not? Like as a clinician perspective, one should always think whether this procedure is going to help your patient or not. I think that is very, very important. Whatever innovation is there, it doesn't mean that you have to use it. You have purchased a PGT facility or you have installed a PGT facility, that doesn't mean that you have to offer it to everyone.
True.
So that is like clinician will always decide and should decide whether this technology is going to increase the chances or it is going to be benefiting your patient or not. That is one thing. If you keep that thing in mind, I think that technology can be used wisely in your clinical program. Second thing, you have to see, is there any major risk reported using that technology? If the evidence is not there, unless evidence is not there, you will have to use the technology. But if a major risk is reported and you continue to use that technology, that is not right. So major risk should not be there. Minor risk, so you have to basically use the formula of benefit risk assessment before using a technology. And third thing, which is very important, what is the probability of increasing the success rate by using that technology? So if you keep these three things in mind, I think you can use a technology, whether it is ICSI for that matter, or PGT, or very recent mitochondrial replacement therapy. These are not only three things. We are having a lot of things like freeze all concept. See, freezing is, we know that freezing is good, and there are a lot of studies which have shown that the frozen transfer gives a better milieu and better outcome. But should we use freeze all in all patients? I think because there is not enough data to suggest. We have to assess the long-term risk of freezing until unless we do that. And whether it can be used in your setup or not. Again, that is very important. So you have to keep these things in mind whenever you are switching over to an innovation or a concept. I don't know about the ICSI for all, because that is the debate which keeps on we keep on discussing. If you see the data, we know that ICSI is not good for all patients. Okay, non male factor patients, and you also highlighted that the same thing. But if you look at the data, global data, now we are having more than 85% of the cycles globally going for ICSI.
Yes.
So I think we need to review that thing, whether it is really giving a better result, that's why it is being done, or because something is driving that movement, that ICSI for all, or we are moving towards the ICSI. Okay. So I will like your comment on that. First.
Okay, so see, basically, sir, when we are trying off any new technology, all our technologies, I would say majority of our technologies are skill driven. So whenever any data comes in on anything, it is by a particular people with a particular skill set. So if we say oocyte vitrification, for example, if a particular reports, it is for a people who have, say, a high level of experience in that. So we cannot compare that skill set with that of a novice. Second thing is, when there are technologies being used, if somebody is doing everything all the time, does it make it safe? I mean, there's nothing to question the safety of ICSI, I would say, but do we need to do anything invasive if there are options available? Because if we talk about all the data that is coming in, comparing ICSI with conventional IVF and non-male factor, nothing shows that it is better. So why are we adding on work? Why are we adding on invasiveness? Then it is not required. So it would be prudent to do technologies where they are required, or I would say, okay, we would use where we are in a gray zone, where we are unsure. If it's unexplained infertility, it's not male factor, maybe prudent to go for ICSI, then go for conventional IVF. So possibly, you know, when there is no evidence now, otherwise we can always say my experience, but when there is no evidence and there are many, many papers which have come in, say last few years, they came in where the skills of ICSI have been at the optimal level now. So now it's not that it is a skill set that comes in. But despite that, we are not seeing any great advantage of effectiveness of ICSI. So if for ICSI for all, I mean, not effectiveness ICSI per se, ICSI for all. So then is it prudent to be using it for everybody? And maybe if we were to really find out, are people using it for convenience? Then it's a different story. Because yes, it's more convenient to use ICSI. It alters my workload, my planning. Then it's a different story. Then we come down to the conclusion that maybe that can be used for people with the highest skill set. So if there are many things which make us take a decision, like you rightly said, to go for a technology. One is benefits of the patient, which should be the priority, but sometimes we find that it's not going to harm the patient. And let me add on this technology because it's more convenient to me. So that could also be the reason we are adding technologies. And I can't sit in judgment like to say whether a convenience of a clinic it should be questioned, because after all the members of the team have to work efficiently. So there are these many other concerns that come in, like you rightly said, if you have got a PGT, the technology, and just because I have it with me, should I offer it to all? Because that would in fact help me gain more experience, you know, working with. So these are very difficult decisions. Unfortunately, it's not a very clear cut kind of thing. But yeah, for certain things where we have enough data which shows that there is no additional benefits, maybe we can be more cautious, I would feel, because we are not seeing any great benefit of using it.
Yeah, and another thing, like banning any procedure, because then you highlighted, like in Netherlands, MISA and PISA was banned, and almost 10 years passed when they again allowed. So I think that is another thing which we have to keep in mind, that banning a procedure or innovation is not the answer to the problem, because if you are not using the technology in right perspective and just banning it for a reason which is not substantiated.
Yes.
Okay. So until unless it is having a major ethical concern or major safety concern, I think we need to produce, as a clinician, and as a embryologist, we need to produce the data.
Correct.
We have to analyze the data and then to reach a conclusion whether we can use it for that particular purpose or not.
Yes, sir.
So I think that is the right approach for clinicians, embryologists, as well as to the authorities who are making the decision.
Right, sir.
See, you are thinking as a clinician, you are thinking that by using this technology or by this concept, you can help your patient to conceive. But the other person who is deciding authority is not is going the other way.
Sure.
So the coordination between the clinician and who is the providing the service provider and the person who is deciding whether it is to be used or not, it needs to be there to have the innovation in right perspective in your clinical platform. I think it was a wonderful review of all these procedures. Is there any question? I don't
see
here any.
I see a couple of questions.
So there are 7 questions that we can see.
Yeah. So where are they? I can't see.
In the show Q&A section, sir, it's there.
Just a minute.
So
the first one is how do you see genetics getting implemented post ART bill? What's the way forward?
Well, the ART bill, whatever that was put up before the lockdown, it mentioned, we haven't seen the bill, we just saw flyers about what were the highlights. We did mention about pre-implantation genetic testing being mandatory, but we don't really know what the bill actually says. So I think we will need to wait to see what the bill actually says, because practically, it's just not possible to do pre-implantation genetic testing for all the embryos. First, we do not have that many skilled individuals. The risk involved when we are doing biopsies with subskilled not optimally skilled, the cost that would be so drastic. So I don't think we can be biopsying each and every embryo. Possibly our pregnancy rates will in fact come down if you are going to biopsy and do a pre-implantation genetic testing on all the embryos. However, we would rather wait and see what the bill is actually stating before actually commenting on what we presume the bill is saying.
Yeah, Rajvi, there's another question on epigenetics. I think that is a very good question. We keep on talking on of epigenetics effect by various procedures, whatever we are doing, the epigenetics come into the place. But not many studies are there to show that there is a gross change as far as the outcome is concerned. So what is your view on that?
I do think that epigenetics would be playing a role on ART when we are culturing embryos in vitro in an external environment. The early developmental changes that take place, I wouldn't even call the development, the embryological changes that take place would be affected by the environment. Because let's take a simple but important parameter of pH of the culture medium. And there are studies that have shown that even a minute variation in the pH, external pH of the medium, reflect in embryos not developing, a percentage of teenage embryos coming down with less than 0.1 unit of the pH change, and also the number of embryos that develop, cleaved embryos that develop to blastocysts. And the reason they say is the epigenetic changes. So if the change is so drastic, then the embryos don't develop. Even if they develop, maybe they don't implant, or the number of cells in the blastocysts are lesser. And even if they do implant, there could be early pregnancy loss. And some of the reports have actually extended it still further to explain that it is because of the epigenetic changes that we are getting low birth babies in IVF. Because let's say an IVF pregnancy is taken care of much more than any normal pregnancy. You know, I'm sure the lady herself takes a lot of care and the clinicians also take a lot of care. Then why are there reports of higher low birth weight babies? Is it something to do with the environment in which the embryo grows? We do not know. But preliminary, there are some animal studies which do reflect on epigenetics playing a role in ART. So that's the reason we are so very careful about our pH and temperature and trying to work in as close an environment and as fast as possible. So yes, I think.
So can we say like that, that higher number of miscarriage in ART pregnancy and low conception rate, which we are having yet, in spite of all advances, we are still not crossed more than 50% success rate. So do you think this is the epigenetics which is causing this these phenomena?
I would not attribute it all to epigenetics, because we are having many embryos and they could be just genetically abnormal, and that's the rationale behind which we are doing a PGTA. So, you know, it could be just chromosomal aneuploidies which are leading to losses when we are doing. But supposing after a PGTA, we are not getting high pregnancy rates. You know, we have taken care of the aneuploidy, and after that also we are not getting very high pregnancy rates, then comes in possibly the potential role of epigenetics. So unless you are doing actual studies, even without in the absence of studies, I would say there are multi factors. One is, of course, epigenetics. One could be inherent disorders that do exist, which we are able to put in. I mean, let's face it, when you put an embryo in, we are not even sure whether it's living. So
yeah, there is another question here. Can electronic witnessing technology create a new safety standard inside the lab?
The safety, what we were talking about in terms of what I have been talking right through the talk, is not in terms of human errors. It's safety for the birth of a healthy child or a healthy offspring, as far as we can monitor. But yes, witnessing systems would definitely reduce. Any kind of witnessing will reduce human errors. And human beings, as long as we are there, we are going to make mistakes. We can, with all our skills, alertness, etc., we're still human. And errors are possible, so we will reduce to a great, great extent, or I would say we could just possibly avoid errors made by humans by mix-ups and things like that by witnessing technology. So yes. I mean, it's mandatory witnessing, and electronic if you can manage, great.
There is another question, of course, not related to the today's subject. What are the potential technologies for sperm selection for ICSI? So I think this is the last question, so you can answer that.
So basically, there are many technologies where we get a better yield of good sperm. So our chance of selecting a genetically normal sperms is higher. So if we say selecting, looking at the sperm, we had IMSI. So where you are actually having nearly 6,200 times magnification and preventing to pick up sperms with vacuoles. But as we know, it has not become a technology which is there 100%. Then we also have technologies which improve the number of sperms which are normal, and therefore the probability of us picking up a healthy sperm is higher. We have the PICSI, physiological ICSI. We have the PICSI dishes. Then we also have the MAX. Then we have the microfluidics. So there are many technologies which help us select better sperms overall. So the percentage of abnormal sperms is much lesser. And then we, when we use them for ICSI, we definitely have better chances of injecting a normal sperms.
So I think if there's no more questions, we can sum up today's talk. It was a really wonderful platform and a wonderful lecture by Rajvi. But I see as far as the innovations are concerned, innovations are there and they are going to be there in the ART program. That is number one. So you cannot avoid innovation just by saying that there will be risk and that's why it cannot be used. So all innovations or whatever new methods or new concepts are suggested, they will have risk. Only thing is you have to weigh the effectiveness and risk ratio. Risk benefit ratio has to be there. If there is a major risk reported, or even after using, if you are having that there is a major risk, it should not be used. That is number one. That is very important. If there is a major risk, major congenital defect reported, you have to be a little more careful. There are many unforeseen theories which keeps on coming. You have to test these theories and then take the decision. We have not discussed about the cost. Innovations, whenever you are adding the innovations, your program is going to be costly. I think that is another major factor in deciding whether you have to use. So until unless it is making a difference in your program, and it is increasing the cost. If it is increasing the cost and making the difference, yes, it becomes a useful innovation. But if it is not making a difference in your program and increasing the cost, I think you have to be a little careful using that innovation. Like there are so many, I will not name because the time is limited, but there are many innovations which are there, which came and people continue to use them without any benefit. So I think you have to look into that thing also. And last thing is, whenever there is extended indication, you have to be a little careful before you start using that for that particular indication. You have to do your own studies. You have to search the literature. You have to review the literature and then decide whether this is good for your patient or not. So I think these are the points, and you have to make a balance between the efficacy and safety before putting a new innovation or new concept in your program. So I think that will sum up today's journal club. If there's anything, Rajvi, you want to add?
Yeah, actually, it's a, you know, when we talked about the role of epigenetics, I was primarily referring to epigenetic concerns in the laboratory as an embryologist. But Dr. Sanjay Shukla has made a very apt comment that when we're talking of epigenetics, we are talking of all the factors that go during a pregnancy. So it starts right from the diet, stimulation, culture environment, which is what I highlighted extensively, to ET. So I think that's a valid point, that we often see epigenetics and we refer to genes and we think of the lab environment, but it's also the environment in which the oocyte is being formed, the sperm is being formed, and also in which the embryo grows. So thank you very much, and thanks Dr. Kuldeep for this wonderful summing up.
It was really wonderful platform.
Thank you, Dr. Kuldeep. Fantastic, Anantam.
And I will like to thank Cooper Surgical again for providing this platform. And of course, it is a joint program of IFS, ISAR, and ACE. So it is really a wonderful platform. And we hope to have more and more program like this, where we can reach to some conclusion. And it is beneficial to everyone. So thank you very much.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, everyone. Thanks for joining in. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.